Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning, everyone online. Welcome to Village Church Atlanta. We're really happy to see everyone. Really glad y'all are here. My name's Tricia, if you don't know me. And this is the first time I've led worship in over 4 years. So I'm just a bit nervous. I just want y'all to just enjoy this time that we have to just kind of focus on God. And I feel like there's a theme this morning in the music, and it's about God's love for us, how unconditional, how just unfailing and unending it is. And so as we're singing this morning, I'd like you just to kind of sit with that for a bit and let that just fill your heart and your soul. Father God, we just thank you for a chance to just come into this place together and just celebrate your love for us. Thank you for all you've done in our lives. Thank you all for all you're doing and that you will do. If we could just stand for the first song, if you're able to, that would be awesome.
Call me out, you know.
you can stand or you can sit. It's up to you. The next song I wanted to sing is oldie but goodie. I hadn't heard it probably in about 20 years. And then I heard it recently a couple of times, and it just really kind of spoke to me. The title of the song is El Shaddai, which is one of the names of God in Hebrew. And it has a lot of different definitions, but the definition I've been sitting with all week is God of the mountains, God of the wilderness. And as I was thinking about that, I couldn't help but think about that he's also the God of everywhere in between. And I don't know about you, but I tend to live in the in-between. Very rarely on the mountaintop, sometimes in the wilderness, but it's in the in-between that I seem to encounter God most. It's in the mundane that seems to be when God shows up. And so this morning when we're singing about El Shaddai, God of the mountains and God of the wilderness, he's the God of everywhere in between as well. El Shaddai, El Shaddai.
We will breathe. Give me hope. Tell of who you are.
Is going to come up and say a prayer for us and also talk about opportunity to give to the village.
Thank you, Tricia. Man, this is my first time up here, actually. This is interesting that the sound guy and the guy who does the online stream and the guy who runs the words on the screen is actually going to leave and come up on the stage. So this is a big moment for me. They don't ever let me have a microphone. That might be for the good. I don't know. But welcome, everybody. Thank you for being here today. Like Tricia said, my name is Derek. I am kind of in the back with Lewis. We run all the tech here, and the big reason we have tech is because of people like you, for people who are grateful and want a place like the village to thrive. If you feel inclined and want to give, we never tell everybody, like, hey, you have to give. I'm outside, I'm gonna start checking your pockets when you leave, right? We don't do that. We just say, if you just have the want in your heart to give and to keep this amazing place as amazing as it is, and maybe even more, we have the QR code, you can snap a photo with that, open up the camera app, do that, a QR code reader app, or you can go online to thevillageatlanta.com/give or text 404-998-8979, or if you're here in person, the wonderful Miss Rachel Northcutt is back after being away for a couple weeks, and she can do any card payments or any sort of monetary donations. This will be the first prayer I ever say at the village. This has been a weekend for me. God, thank you for the assembly of these great, great people. I wouldn't ever want to be around anyone else who don't have the love that the people here have for you and for each other and for the community and for everybody else who is just needing a place that they can call home. Thank you for bringing us all together on this kind of cold morning. And thank you for Tricia bringing this amazing, amazing talent and giving her everything she needed to come and perform and play and sing and worship for us after 4 years. You're a great and awesome God. Thank you. Amen.
No, I did not have anything in my water this morning. Just have some balance issues every now and again. If you'd like to stand, we're gonna do one more song before we bring up our wonderful speaker, Stan, okay? Another song about the love of God. How awesome is that? Oops. Play the right chords.
I've been held.
Now I wanted to welcome our speaker this morning, our teaching pastor here at The Village, Stan Mitchell. I love to listen to this man teach. So, Stan, it's all yours.
Thank you, Trish. Thank you. Well, I knew that was going to be good, but that was better than I even imagined it could be. That was beautiful. Wasn't that lovely? So lovely. Such a lovely person, in spite of the fact that she's an Eagles fan. In spite of. You know, there's another team in Pennsylvania that actually, some of us, yeah. Well, thanks, Trish. That really was lovely. Well, good to be here. Hate that Ray and Jane's not here, but that's why I'm here, right? So let me do something with you guys. Just hop right into it, because I know I'm amongst friends, and you'll accept this and hopefully appreciate it. A couple of months ago, I told you I was going to give the synopsis of this overarching theme of my life, at least theme at the center of what I consider to be my worldview, my theology, the way I look at God. And it derives from the story in Genesis 3, right? That wonderful story that is the story of all of us. That story we call the story of Adam and Eve, the story of the fall, where in Dr. Doolittle-ish form, a serpent slithers into a garden. Two people are talked into eating a forbidden fruit, and things go awry from that day forward. Well, I was going to give a synopsis that day of the overarching theme, and I think I got it started fairly well. But to finish that off, probably not to finish it off, but to try to put as neat a bow as I can on it, I'm going to read to you, because I've this entire synopsis, I think, of the biblical story, I have written in what I would call a book. Now, it's not a book anybody's read, but it's a book I've written. And chapter 9 of that book really goes back and reviews and then tries to summarize what I think really is the crux of the story. So just act like you're at a library today. And Gene, I'm about to read my memoir to you. Every time I'm down here, I go over to Jean's house and she reads me another chapter of her memoir. If you haven't, I'm not going to invite them, but it is exquisite writing. I told Jean the other day, Mark, she's one of the few people I listen, read, and I envy. Because sometimes you hear people do art in a way that you think to yourself, that's beautiful, and then it's also demoralizing because you think, I could never do that. And it's that level of writing. So I hope, I say that to say, I hope you will enjoy me reading this a fourth as much as I enjoy listening to Gene read. When I mention a book, just forget about the book and think about this overarching zeitgeist, this worldview of mine. That's what I'm referring to. I begin with one verse from Genesis 3, and it's verse 21. And we'll probably come to more verses in Genesis 3 than this, but it's a good place to start. And the Lord God made garments of animal skins for the man and for his wife, and he clothed them. You know what? I'm not as young as I used to be. Oh, what a relief. And the Lord God made garments of animal skins for the man and for his wife, and he clothed them. Well, here we are. Exactly where this book and the biblical text it has been exploring intended for us to be. The story told in Genesis 3 is a carefully crafted story written to lead us to one remarkably important question. A question that is the single most important question presently facing, I believe, Christianity. Single most important question maybe that has ever faced Christianity. This book has been written not just to ask that question, but to answer it, or to at least respond to it. Actually, to let the Bible respond to it, because it does, resoundingly. It is not an overstatement to say that the answer to this important question carries the potential to change everything. Our individual lives, our relationships, Christianity itself, and I think the whole world. Per that question, At the end of that fateful, foundational day described in Genesis 3, God and the first couple finally came face to face. Once there, the three of them were left to deal with what had transpired earlier that day, leading to that pivotal encounter. Adam and Eve's unbelief, their mistaken ideas about God, about themselves, about the fruit. In that pivotal encounter, they were left, the three of them, to deal with Adam and Eve's shame, their estrangement, their sin, their fig leaves, their fear, their hiding, all of it. As the chapter, Genesis 3, closes, the text reveals that as a part of the reckoning process, animals were sacrificed. The lives of the animals were taken that their hides might provide covering, clothing for Adam and Eve, two people who were distraught with their nakedness. And so it is that every step of the story up to and including that moment of sacrificial covering was carefully developed and positioned by its author. Together, all of the events build an effective foundation on which to ask the momentous question I have been mentioning. But before we ask that question, let's take care to recap the steps. The story tells us, one, God created Adam and Eve in the divine image. That divine image was described as naked and not ashamed. Isn't that interesting? Not naked and not sinful, naked and not ashamed. The pristine human soul was not first described as a soul absent of sin. It was a soul absent of shame. For all of the remarkable ballyhoo we've made about sin, the Bible begins by saying they were naked and they were not ashamed. Two, they possessed perfect union with God. Three, God gave them one prohibition. It was very clear. They were not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Four, the serpent came. Five, the serpent lied to Eve. Six, Eve fell for the serpent's twin lies of separation and not enoughness. Seven, Eve saw that the fruit was good, quote unquote. Eight, after seeing that the fruit was desirable, she took the fruit. Nine, she ate the fruit. 10, she shared the fruit with Adam. 11, their eyes were opened. 12, their shame spread to their bodies, interestingly, especially manifesting in their loins. 13, to deal with this shame, they covered themselves with decaying leaves, leaves that would not last. 14, God came walking into the garden in search of them. 15, they heard the sound of God's footsteps. They recognized the approach of God. 16, their response to God's approach was to hide from God amongst the trees. 17, God, most certainly knowing where they were, stopped short of their location and called for them. 18, the sound of God's voice was different than the sound of God's footsteps in their ears. They responded to God's voice by coming out from their hiding. 19, God asked them questions. 20, they confessed their thoughts and feelings. 21, God explained to them the consequences of their sin and shame. 22, God took animal skins and clothed or covered the pair. As stilted as it might have felt to read the word then leading each of the step statements after the first three, its repetitive use was intentional as each step of the story necessarily led to the next. Each of these points were made vividly by the textual writer. With the story in mind now and serving as a very strategic and instructive foundation, the vital question begged for the church, not just macro, but the church and all of us. Vital question is begged. And though at first blush the question may seem innocuous, the need, the mandate even for us to answer this question correctly cannot be overstated. And here's the question. In Genesis 3, did Adam and Eve sacrifice the animals to cover their sin so God could be comfortable with them? Or did God sacrifice the animals to cover the couple's shame so they could be comfortable with God? It's a good question. Ask again, the question might be queried this way. Did the Bible's first sacrificial covering, we call it propitiation in theological circles, did the Bible's first sacrificial covering serve to cover the couple's sin and satisfy God's holiness? Or did it serve to cover the couple's shame and heal their fear? One more time. Did God need the sacrifice in order to be comfortable in the presence of Eve and Adam? Or did Eve and Adam need the sacrifice so they could be comfortable in the presence of God? The story in Genesis 3 is remarkably clear, though we have not made it that way. The story is incredibly clear. God was not the one struggling that day to figure out a way to be with Adam and Eve. Nor did God spend the day laying the foundation for a complex religious system capable of satisfying God's holiness or disdain for sin. God already possessed the only thing necessary to be with them, the only thing necessary to go looking for them, the only thing necessary to cover them. God possessed that only thing. It's called love. It is not animal skins, blood, or sacrifice that covers a multitude of sins. It's always been love. Their sins were covered before the couple came out from behind the trees. Their sins were covered before the animals died to provide their hides as coverings. Their sins were covered before God took the couple's fig leaves off and replaced them with the skins. Their sins were covered before they even committed them. Later biblical authors would agree, hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all sins. 1 Peter 4:8, in reference to Proverbs 10 and 12, reminds us again in the New Testament, above all, maintain constant love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Even Adam were covered by God's love. Their sin, their frailty, their imperfection was a part of them. So that means their sin was just as covered by love as they were, period. In other words, love doesn't find a way or a process or a tool or a mechanism to cover sin. It just does it. Love is the covering. God's presence with them after they had eaten the fruit proved as much. They were the ones who wrongly believed they were separated from God, believing that lie even before they sinned. That's where doctrinal calisthenics and complicated religious systems come from. Not from God, but from us. From our age-old struggle to trust in the bedrock of divine love and goodness. Adam and Eve are the archetype of that struggle. They were the ones struggling with false voices, forbidden fruit, fig leaves, and hiding places, all in an effort to sort out a separation that only existed in their minds, a separation of a psychological sort we call estrangement, not technically true, but felt deeply. The fact is, they weren't separated from God after their sin any more than they were before their sin. Put plainly, they weren't separated from God because of their sin. Conversely, they sinned because they thought they were separated from God. As you might suspect, after they ate the fruit, adding sin to their life, they followed the lie out to its insidiously logical end, like we all have, believing their sin now underscored and magnified that separation that they had always believed true. And so Eve and Adam's impact on the human family was not that they irrevocably corrupted our DNA by their sin or misguided choice to eat the forbidden fruit. No, their contribution is much deeper and infinitely more hopeful than that. The couple's actual gift to us is that they show us from whence our struggles truly derive. Our loss of confidence in ourselves, our loss of trust in God, the loss of our belief in that inviolable relationship. Beautifully, at the precise moment their struggle reached its most fevered pitch, at the moment they cowered behind fig leaves and trees and bushes, God came walking in the garden. At the moment they most believed they were separated from God and could never be reunited, that is when God tenderly called for them, lovingly spoke with them, and gently covered them, tending not only to their sin, tending also to their shame. When they were lost in the lie of separation, deep in the psyche of estrangement, we've named it, God came. Truth be told, of their spiritual illnesses, it seems sin may have been the simplest for God to tend to. While Adam and Eve had a choice as to whether or not they would sin, as well as a choice as to how they would respond to their sin, they were not on the committee that made the decision as to how God would respond to their failure. That committee had only one member, and the vote was unanimously cast before Adam and Eve were created. Nothing could separate them from God. The fact is, people don't have a choice as to whether or not they are forgiven. They do have a choice, though, in whether or not they live in and out of that fullness or the fullness of that gift. And just there is where shame comes in. It is shame, not sin, that calls to the Father that lays across him, "I am not worthy. Simply call me a slave." Shame. So when their creator came walking in the garden that day, the first couple learned, or at least were offered the lesson, that God's holiness and God's love were not competing virtues in the character of the divine. God's holiness and God's love were not competing virtues in the psyche of the divine. The two virtues weren't even held in some sort of complex tension, needing Luther or Calvin, Zwingli, Pascal, Paul. The two virtues weren't held in some sort of complex tension, needing a complicated religious algorithm to resolve. The pure perfection of God's holiness wasn't a record of sinlessness. It was love, undying and unfailing love. Love was holy. Love was not held in tension with holiness. Love was holiness, and holiness was love. Nothing's changed. Adam and Eve witnessed a holy love, a loving holiness that worked not in spite of the couple's sin, but regardless of it. If you read the story at face value, it seems the only thing God would have deemed divine imperfection that day would have been if God failed to be with the couple in their greatest hour of need. They would have been holy completely. That would have been holy and completely unholy and completely unloving. Of course, I know for those of us that have been a part of the Christian church, I know that another question is loudly begged by all of this, and that is, why has the Christian church for so long and so persistently interpreted this story through the classic doctrinal lens of sin, separation, sacrifice, and salvation? How have we missed the simple extravagance and impeccability of God's holy love revealed in this story? Why have we not seen the unconditional and unremitting nature of God's presence in our lives as told by this ancient tale? And in turn, why have we created the intricate religious doctrines and systems, baptisms and sacraments, altars and altar calls? Why have we created these things we believed were necessary to satisfy divine holiness and save us from God's righteous wrath? How have we gotten so far off? The answer to that question is resting on the very visible surface of the story itself. Remember, the story in Genesis 3 is not a story of God trying to find a legal way to be with us, but a story of our struggle to accept that God is ever and always just there with us. And therein lies the answer. Adam and Eve's story, above all else, teaches us that humans are naturally prone to struggle with acceptance as it relates to God's love and their worth. It teaches us that those of us who were born naked and not ashamed wrestle early with that nakedness, wrestle early with that absence of shame. The story of Adam and Eve teaches us that we have long possessed a penchant to formulate doctrines and construct systems in an unnecessary effort to be comfortable in our own skins with one another and with God. Not much has changed. We are inherently united with God. God is with us even when we don't believe it. God comes to us when we think we don't deserve it. We eat fruit acquired by a pitiable theft to attain something we already possess by gift. We feel shame when we shouldn't. We share it with one another. We religiously and addictively cover parts of ourselves that don't need to be covered. And into that morass, that soulless morass, God comes. And we hide. And God calls. And fearfully, tentatively, we come out. We come out shaking beneath these decaying fig leaves that have to be replaced again and again and again. And we are uncovered. We tremble in our uncovering. And then tenderly, we are covered. We take healing journeys with God beyond the place where our innocence was lost. We take an Edenic journey in a non-Edenic world, birthed, born, and fired with Edenic palates. We try to find our way, God with us, in a world east of those flaming gates. With our sin long forgiven, our shame hangs on in this Edenic journey in a non-Edenic world. Our shame hangs on, doesn't it? Billboards and magazines, body images, sexual shame, caste and class, zip codes. We take healing journeys. With our sin long forgiven, our shame hangs on, refuses to let go, and we struggle to believe so good a news. We needlessly hedge our bets. As religious people, we hedge our bets by creating supplemental religious insurance and coverage just in case. Religious Aflac, riders beyond what is necessary, just in case. And God is there, knowing we'll never need those policies nor their coverage. God is there watching us do all of these silly coverings that we do. God is there knowing we are already covered, for He is the coverer. God is the one that, as we cry beneath the blows of love, we are not worthy. Call us ashamed, never call us child again. God is the one saying, quickly, someone kill a fatted calf. Quickly, someone get a ring and a robe. We are already covered. Always have been, always will be. Not much has changed. In other words, instead of the Genesis 3 story building a case for and justifying all of our ideas about sin and atonement and salvation, it actually does the exact opposite, promising us that we don't need those things. We don't have to build those systems. We don't have to think those thoughts. We don't need to be saved from God's wrath because God is not wrathful. Instead of getting saved, we need only to accept and celebrate that we have always been safe. This isn't just good news, this is great news. As Eve and Adam stood there that day, the forgiveness of their sins, i.e., the reality that their sin was totally covered and processed by God's love, proved too difficult a thing to just believe and accept. The reality of God's presence in their lives and the complete unnecessariness of their fig leaves and their hiding was more than they could take in. And that is the persistence of shame. So the God who was with them there, knew there was work yet to do in their souls. After removing their fig leaves and saying, there, these are unnecessary, God watched those four eyes. God watched as they diverted, narrowed, and closed. God watched as their faces flushed, the redness coming from their internal discomfort, their shame, not from outside of them, from the non-existent fire of God's disdain, disapproval, and judgment. They were fired red that day from the inside. Shame, not enoughness, inadequacy, even in the presence of the eternal love. Squirming and disconsolate, unable to accept the peace of their inviolable relationship with God. Naked and ashamed they were. Sensitive to both the power and the place of their disease, God responded to their shame by taking animal skins, tenderly covering their loins, this most sensitive part of their life. Tenderly covering their reproductive parts, their sexuality, the place most aching with and undone by shame. God did what God does and tended to the vulnerable place, the wounded place, the struggling place in them. Only the sacred voice that tenderly calls, "Where are you, boy? Where are you, girl? Why are you hiding? And who told you you were naked?" Only that voice has the ability to coax us out from the bushes we hide behind. And only the tender surgical hands of the one who calls us from our hiding can disrobe and disabuse us of our useless addictive coverings. Yes, these are the hands that sew sufficient coverings for our shame. Cast in bandages they are, not permanent burdens to bear, burdens that will leave us only sicker with shame. There's no doubt the first covering witnessed in the story was a covering for sin. And that covering was not a covering created by God. It was a covering ignorantly, misguidedly created by the two. But there was another covering that day. A covering accomplished by God's love and revealed by God's coming to the couple after they ate the fruit. God's unconditional presence in their lives. Sin could never separate the couple from God. Love covers all sin. The second covering witnessed in the story was just as important, a covering for shame. A covering accomplished by God's love. Shame's stubborn strain demanded more than God's abiding presence for its resolve. Certainly God was covering their shame that day by coming to them and by calling for them, but as they came out from the trees and spoke with God about their sin, its roots and its result, it was obvious something more was needed. A reassurance, if you will. A ring for the finger, a robe, and the killing of a fatted calf to console the disconsolate prodigals. God provided that something more by taking animal skins and clothing the couple with them. Clearly, that act of sacrificial covering was for the couple's sake, not God's. God's holiness was not being satisfied that day. Their discomfort was being tended. If God had any discomfort that day, it was only that they were uncomfortable, and that would not do. Forgiveness was not enough. Adam and Eve needed healing. After lovingly covering their shame, God then did something else that has long been the object of much unfortunate misunderstanding. Genesis 3 says, "Then the Lord God said, 'See, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. And now he might reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever.' Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a sword flaming and turning to guard the way to the tree of life." For years, I mistakenly understood the event described by the above verses to be the exclamation point on the doctrines of original sin, inherent separation, divine wrath, and substitutionary atonement. The pair sinned, and God had to kick them out of the garden. The message seemed very straightforward, and as a matter of fact, it was. It is, but in exactly the opposite direction of how I long read the text. This famous end of the famous story does exactly what the rest of the story does. It loudly proclaims the good news of inherent union, of no separation, the forgiveness of sins, and the healing of shame. To begin with, God put them out of the Garden of Eden, not out of God's presence. They were put out of a botanical place, not out of divine presence. The garden was their home, not God's. God is everywhere. God put them out of the garden because it was no longer safe for them, explicitly explaining why. And it wasn't because God was angrily cleaning the riffraff out of his house. God was protecting Adam and Eve from forever living in their present condition of shame. And now he, Adam, might reach out his hand and take from the tree of life and live forever like this. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden. God wasn't protecting the Garden of Eden from them. God was protecting them from the Garden of Eden. Specifically, God was protecting them from a tree that if they ate of its fruit would cause them to live forever in their current condition of shame. This was God's way of saying, I will not let you live like this forever. In other words, I won't leave you this way. Remember, they had already eaten the fruit of a tree about which God had said, in the day you eat of its fruit, you will die. The fact that they did not biologically die that day leaves us to understand that the death God spoke of another nature, another kind of dying. Surely this book and that story paint a clear picture of that kind of dying. Furthermore, that dying would not simply be reversed by them eating from the tree of life now in question. It seems God knew these things would just be made worse. Their dying from the previous tree would not be nullified by the garden, but would become interminable. They would not go back to living, but now would be forever dying. Lest we get lost in the thick and unhelpful weeds of raw literalism, these were not two magical trees serving as poison and antidote, but two metaphors painting the picture that God did not want them nor us just physically surviving. That's not living. It's just forever dying, which is worse than being dead. God wanted Adam and Eve to truly live, so God sent them into a land and on a journey. A land and a journey we live in and continue. With the impact of the first tree, God sent them into this new land to heal from their dying as opposed to staying in the place of their brokenness and living in a tragic Groundhog Day of shame and estrangement. Like so much of this story, what I once understood to be an act of divine punishment, I now see as a tender act of divine preservation. God was saving them, not condemning them. In closing, in my mind's eye, as I think about that fateful day, I can see the pair leaving the garden. And there's no doubt in my mind, their shoulders were stooped and their eyes were cast down. They felt punished and condemned. I'm more than sure they felt an almost unbearable sense of shame, a grinding, inconsolable remorse that they had messed their lives up so far beyond repair. Of course they did. Remember, the entire story in Genesis 3 is built around the couple's continual misunderstanding of God, of themselves, and of the nature of the relationship the three shared. To unlock the value of this text, we have to understand that as much as this story lays the foundation for a proper understanding of God, ourselves, and our relationship with God, it also teaches us how wrong and misguided we as a human family have been and continue to be as it relates to these incredibly vital matters. But in my mind, as I watched them forlornly pass through the gate of their first home, never to return, a little ways down the uncut path that led eastward from the Garden of Eden, I see that inconsolable couple as they hear a sound behind them. As they turn to see the reason for the noise, they see something they would have never expected. They see God, the same God who lovingly came looking for them after they sinned, the one who called for them with such tenderness it drew them from their hiding, the God who disabused them of their faltering fig leaves and clothed them with both unconditional love and animal skins, the latter a careful gift intended to tide them over while the love slowly and committedly worked to heal the shame beneath the animal skins and even deeper beneath their skin. As they left the garden that day, they saw that God. Of course they did. And as they stood on that uncut road and silently stared, still struggling to understand this one from whom they could never be separate, God understood their consistent confusion. Assuming their question, God said, "I'm going with you. I would rather live in hell with you than in heaven without you." That's what holiness is. It's love, nothing more and nothing less. A love that would one day make a tremendous poet and theologian say, "If I spread my wings and fly to the farthest star, and if I make my bed in hell, thou art with me." God was not in love with Eden. He was in love with them. Nothing more and nothing less. Oh, love that will not let me go. Holiness doesn't need reconciled with love. It is made true by love. Many years ago, a now deceased mentor of mine was on vacation with his wife and their then 4-year-old son. After a long day of driving from before the sun was up to after it was down, my friend, his wife, and their 4-year-old finally arrived at their much anticipated vacation spot. As it was the busy season, as well as several hours past check-in, the hotel they had made reservations with months before now had only a room with one bed for the road-weary family. Bone-tired, my friend said they didn't have the energy nor the patience to try to find another hotel with vacancies, so they took the room, unpacked their car, and crawled into the queen-size bed, parentally sandwiching a fitful and stir-crazy 4-year-old boy. Incapable of decompressing himself rationally and reasonably, the worn-out little guy flipped and flopped mercilessly for the better part of an hour. Just about the time he would drift off to sleep, his frazzled little body and swirling mind would flinch and jerk him back awake. As a parent, I can empathetically feel the misery even as I recount the story. Of course, punctuating that miserable hour was a lot of ineffective cajoling and attempts at comfort. Mixed in as well was at least as many unsuccessful warnings and exasperated threats. Finally, somewhere after midnight and completely at the end of his parental rope, my friend, as a young father, told his little boy that if you kick, punch, or prod either of us again, you're going to be banished from the bed and you're going to sleep on the floor. And of course, scarcely had that gauntlet landed before the terminal punch was thrown. True to his word, my friend rolled out of bed against the behest of his wife, and with a mix of cushions, comforter, and clothes, made a place on the floor for their miniature criminal to serve his sentence and spend the rest of the night. Too tired to resist, the exiled little fella tearfully crumpled onto his pallet of punishment. Within minutes, my friend's exhausted wife went fast asleep. My friend said as much as he wanted to follow her lead, he couldn't. Instead, he lay in bed and listened to his son periodically whisper a pitiful SOS, hoping against hope someone up there would suffer a fit of mercy and throw him a lifeline. Every minute or so, the boy would say that he was scared or cold or sad or lonely. Finally, the little guy gave up, left off with his appeals for clemency. My friend said he knew his boy was still awake because even when his pleading words were gone, they had been replaced with intermittent sniffles. Unrelenting but struggling, trying to be consistent as a dad, the young father lay in his bed stewing with questions and self-doubt. Was the punishment meted out too severe? Had it been magnified by everyone's weariness? Was it cruel and unusual? Would it serve to help his 4-year-old boy mature and grow? Or would it be tearfully remembered to a counselor later in adulthood? Or perhaps recounted to sympathetic ears in group therapy, replete with pillow punching? What parent hasn't wondered those thoughts? Finally, listening to the sniffles of his son, my friend said, "I knew what I had to do." He rolled out of his bed one last time that night, would not return, leaving his wife luxuriously alone with the whole bed to herself. Down, 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 the father went, laying his tired body on the hard floor. He told me, I still remember placing my cheek on the pillow that was wet with my boy's tears. I pulled my boy close, and the half-asleep little guy simply said, I knew you would come get me. And there in the cramped confines of a musty roadside motel room, somewhere on a two-lane highway that runs forever east of Eden, there is a parent and child slept the night through on a hard floor instead of returning to a soft bed. The good news was told again. So sin does indeed separate us from the perfect garden of our innocence. Though sin does have its own punishing results, it never separates us from God. That's the true gospel. Not that we can get back into Eden and reunite with God, but that God has gone with us out of Eden. Emmanuel, God with us, even here. And we could never, ever, ever be separated. For down, down, down came the crucified God, not so that we could come up to him, but so that we would know that he has ever and always been with us. There is another way to read our story. There is a better way to read our story. The good news you never needed is that you can be reunited with God. The great news you never heard was that you've never been separated, nor could you ever be. That's a lovely story. And that's a story that's told by our book. Can you say amen? Amen. Father, thank you. Sweet, divine presence of God. Thank you. Thank you that as we lay in the results and the repercussions of our broken ways, you come to us. And as Gary S. Paxton wrote years ago, we realize you were there all the time, waiting patiently in line behind our shame, our inconsolable religious efforts, all of our ways. Waiting patiently in line. Thank you for covering our sin with your love. Thank you for covering our shame with your healing. Thank you for journeying with us, sweet Christ, in this land, this tough, hard land, east of Eden. We pray with thanksgiving, with grateful hearts, full souls. In Christ's name we pray. And God's people said amen. Amen. Go and be good to one another, and I'll see you next week.